deep thought. Welcome. Grace and peace to you in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Welcome to this worship service from Second Presbyterian Church in Portsmouth, Ohio. And whether you are worshiping here in the building, over the radio waves, or the Facebook live stream, or watching this afternoon by way of the YouTube broadcast. I am Reverend Beth Rice, and I am happy to be leading this service of worship in the absence of our pastor, Reverend Bauer, as she enjoys holiday time with her family. We are grateful, as always, for the musical leadership of Dr. Stanley Workman from our organ bench, and for Dr. Caroline Wall for providing our anthem for today. And thanks is due to the many capable people who make our broadcast technically possible, so that we might be with you, whether you are in our building, over the radio waves, or on the internet. We are grateful that you are worshiping with us today, wherever you are. And our prayer is that God will come close to you in this time of worship and give you whatever it is that you need this day. For this is the day that the Lord has made, and let us rejoice and be glad in it. O God of generous love and mercy, how good it is to sing your praises. Your steadfast love has been known in all generations, and we get to celebrate that love this day. As we place our hope in you, come near to us in our time of worship and speak into our hearts. Amen. Dr. Wall this morning looked at me and said, "You get to lead the congregation in music." And I looked at her and I didn't know what to say, and I said, "I don't sing." But I can lead us into a call to worship, and I can pray and preach, but don't ask me to sing to one person. Let us join together in our call to worship. You'll find it there. Loving God, you tell us to fear not, for I am with you, to not be dismayed, for I am your God. You uphold us with your righteous right hand. We stumble in darkness, crying out to you, Lord. Your light transfigures our way. Lord, I exalt you, my companion, my guide upon the way. You shine on those living in darkness to guide our feet into the path of peace. Living flame, burn into us. Cleansing wind, blow through us. Savior of the Word, hide us in the shadow of your wings, and may your presence give us joy for the journey. And let us pray. Gracious God, we have wounded your love, our sins too heavy to carry. We forget that we are your home. Spirit of God, dwell in us. Free us from a past we cannot change. Prepare us for a future that we cannot even begin to imagine. And grant us the courage to live within your immeasurably more. Gracious God, help us to attend to your voice that speaks through the scriptures. Open our hearts and our minds to receive your truth deep into our souls, so that we will be transformed by your power and be light to others. Thank you, Lord, for the gift of your presence now and always. Amen.
Son of man, the hidden years had ended.
Scripture reading comes to us from Isaiah chapter 9, verses 2 through 6. Hear what the Spirit is saying to the church. The people who walked in darkness have seen a great light. Those who dwelt in a land of deep darkness, on them light has shone. You have multiplied the nation. You have increased its joy. They rejoice before you as with joy at the harvest, as they are glad when they divide the spoil. For the yoke of his burden and the staff for his shoulder, the rod of his oppressor, you have broken as on the day of Midian. For every boot of the trampling warrior in battle tumult and every garment rolled in blood will be burned as fuel for the fire. But for us, a child is born. To us a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulder, and his name shall be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Light of mine, I'm glad it
you for ushering us to the feet of Jesus. Our second scripture reading comes from the second chapter of Matthew, verses 13 through 15. Hear again what the Spirit is saying to you, the church. Now when they had departed, behold, an angel of the Lord appeared to Joseph in a dream and said, "Rise, take the child and his mother and flee to Egypt, and remain there until I tell you, for Herod is about to search for the child to destroy him." And he rose and took the child and his mother by night and departed to Egypt, and remained there until the death of Herod. This was to fulfill what the Lord had spoken by the prophet, "Out of Egypt I called my son." The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. I think pastors and guest speakers have struggled this week knowing what to say from the pulpit in light of all the stress that we have, I think, all been engaged in this week. I was reminded as I read from one of my favorite people, that a professor by the name of Jim Howard from Denver Seminary told his students this week that, as a reminder, our Creator Redeemer has always been and always will be in the process of restoring human dignity and pointing us to the true north of the gospel of Jesus Christ until he calls us home with him in glory. And his sovereign goodness may sometimes appear to be eclipsed by conflict, cruelty, and destruction that can mar all of us, but there is no image bearer or ideology powerful enough to thwart the supremacy of God's plan and purpose. Let us endeavor to pray with renewed fervor for his will to be done in our word, in our world, and may we all engage authentically and work tirelessly as conduits of reconciliation and restoration and live our lives in a way that reflect God. 2020 has ended and we are living and breathing in a brand new year. I think if we could write a letter to the year 2020, we would probably write, "Dear 2020, I imagined you to be somewhat different." Even this week, periods of darkness. Some of us have called 2020 a year of darkness due to the virus and to many other issues that we have had to deal with. I was reading the story after last Sunday, just to kind of finish up the Christmas story, of how Joseph took Mary and the baby away in the darkness of the night. And I was reminded this week of a verse in Psalm 88:18 that says, "Darkness is my closest friend." Now, I have never really understood that verse, especially when I was young. And I probably admit that I've asked God, why would such a verse even exist in the Bible? And he's had to take me on quite a few adventures to help me understand how darkness could be my closest friend. Many years ago, I experienced a single night of sheer terror in utter darkness. Most of us here, I think, and listening, could say that we have experienced darkness in many forms. And whether it be for a day or a month or a year or a season, periods of darkness. This past year, many of us have experienced physical, financial, mental, emotional, relational, and even spiritual darkness that have caused us to question why God could even consider darkness to be a close friend. Theologian, pastor, and writer Barbara Brown Taylor, author of Learning to Walk in the Dark, defines darkness as any place physically, spiritually, emotionally, or vocationally where one cannot see where he or she is going. Growing up as a kid, I had my own bedroom, and although my sister's room was right next to mine, it often seemed that the minute my parents said lights out, kissed me goodnight, and shut the door, that monsters were lurking behind closet doors and small creaking sounds that I would think nothing of in the light became much louder sounds in the dark, attached to who might be lurking around in my bedroom. Kate Bowler, who's a professor at Duke Divinity School, laughingly told a story, and she wanted us to laugh with her. She said, "To this day, I still sleep on my side facing an open door so I can be sure to see the murderer who is going to come into my bedroom someday." As Christians, I think that we can do a pretty lousy job understanding darkness. Chief among these is the way that Christian teaching thrives on dividing reality into opposing pairs. It's either good or evil, church or the world, spirit or flesh, light or dark. And even if you aren't a Christian, it should be easy to tell which half is higher to God and which half is lower to God. We pray to beat back the powers of darkness so we can get closer to God. Darkness has become a synonym for sin and ignorance, spiritual blindness, and death. We make mistakes or we sin, and we believe the lie that there is no way that God could ever truly forgive us or even use us again lies in the darkness. Darkness has never really been my closest friend. I used to fight it with everything that I had. And then one September night, standing on a hiking path with my roommate Ginger, in the sheer blackness, high up in the mountains on the island of Kauai, Hawaii, the Lord began teaching me his first real lesson about darkness in my life and the lessons that it could teach me. My roommate and I had hiked 11 miles in on the Kalalau Trail, and the trail just rose higher and higher and higher right along the Nepali coastline, and we were hiking to this 200-foot waterfall that we had heard about. The scenery was just unbelievable. Only when we got to the end of our hike, and we did get to the waterfall, we made a very grave error. And we stayed too long splashing in that waterfall base. And we left too late to hike the 11 miles back to the trailhead before it got dark. We got caught on the trail after dark. There were no overhead lights, obviously. The rainforest was so thick, we couldn't even see the stars as we struggled to figure out where the path was to walk. We even struggled because of evening rains that had come and made the path so muddy, our feet were just sliding along the way. My knee got wrenched. You could just say we were struggling in the darkness. We struggled even more to navigate the darkness when we walked right into a herd of wild boars, aka pigs with big, big tusks. It was a long night in the darkness. Darkness is all over Scripture. You know, as we read in Matthew 2, verses 13 to 23, this angel appeared to Joseph in a dream, telling him, "You need to flee to Egypt with Mary and take the baby Jesus because King Herod is threatening to kill him and he's seeking him." Herod had become paranoid that this child, Jesus, was going to threaten his throne one day. And so he initiated this massacre of the innocents, having all male children who were 2 years old and under killed, hoping Jesus would be one of them. Verse 14 says, "And he, Joseph, rose, and he took the child and his mother by night and departed to Egypt." Joseph used the darkness for their escape. I wonder who else in Scripture read in their hearts that darkness is my closest friend. Abraham was told by God, "Go outside in the darkness and look up in the sky and count all the stars if you are able, for so shall your descendants be." Jacob wrestled with an angel by a river all night long in the darkness, surviving the match and receiving a lump, a blessing, and a new name. Joseph dreamed dreams at night in the darkness that caught Pharaoh's attention, an eventual release from a dungeon becoming a royal interpreter. The exodus from Egypt of the Israelites happened at night. God parted the Red Sea at night. Manna fell from heaven at night. Some of God's greatest acts of deliverance happen when we are experiencing the darkness of our soul. That night on the trail, following behind my roommate, she suddenly whispered, "Stop, do not move." Excuse me, we were surrounded by an enemy, and for 7 hours, we did not move. In those 7 hours, with silent tears streaming down my face and my legs feeling like they were going to collapse at any moment, all I had to rely on was God. But you see, God is always enough. I'm sure you know that feeling of silent tears and exhaustion in your own way. And it was as if God whispered to me that night, "Let darkness be your friend tonight, Beth." In the darkness, he became light. In the darkness, all the scriptures that I had ever learned as a child and as an adult, I spoke that night to myself. My key scripture was, "Thy word is a lamp unto thy feet and a light unto my path." Psalm 119:105. Isn't it funny that we can be so down or in trouble, but when we open our Bible with our hearts bowed, God gives us just what we need in the scripture for another manna day. I knew Jesus intimately that night, as did Joseph and Miriam and Hannah, and so many others in the Bible who are familiar with God's intimacy, as you can be familiar with God's intimacy. You see, the good news that I say to you today is that God lives in the dark just like he lives in the light. Darkness is not dark to God. We cannot see the sun at midnight, but he can. We will learn things in the dark we can never learn in the light. Because of this, when we wish to live only in the light, only wanting our lives to be great and perfect and good, we are really wishing for a half-life, because we would only know half of God. We know the beauty of the light of the sun only because we know the beauty of the darkness at night. We know what flowers look like in the day, but we know what stars look like in the dark. We can know who God is in the light, but somehow it seems that we can know his deeper faithfulness and providence in the darkness. When we ask God to teach us lessons of his faithfulness and his steadfast love, of his provision and care that we all so desperately need in hard times, when we are brave and give ourselves the gift of facing and touching those torn places in our lives that are often equated with darkness, the places where they are torn to be so thin, we don't often realize that those are the places where we can touch the peace of God and the hand of God. I am convinced that Satan will do everything he can to wipe out our lives. But see, God knew the rest of my story that night. He even knew, I think, somehow that I would be standing here today. And he knows the rest of your life story. And usually it is the stories of darkness and God's faithfulness spoken to us, out to others. Those are the stories that people stow away in their hearts and minds when they themselves need reminded that God is faithful and good. I call it one of God's spiritual mysteries of what he can teach us and do for us when things seem the darkest. Even wilderness times can have a divine purpose attached to it. I learned that night out on the hike not to panic when surrounded by an enemy. Barbara Brown Taylor would say that in the daytime we can feel pretty self-sufficient, but in the night our walls are down and despair seems darker. So I would say to you, do not panic. Sometimes we just need to stop while we're experiencing darkness. Sometimes we just need to turn off all those things that we use as distractions long enough to hear his voice so we will know how to navigate out with Jesus. I believe that sometimes we need to ask the hard questions while we are in the dark. Like, Lord, where am I being held back from love? Lord, do I need a hard do-over in my life? Lord, are my spiritual rhythms off right now? Lord, am I accepting your love and grace in a world where human love and grace is so conditional? I am here to remind someone today that there is life and light in the dark and after. Amen. We will experience it again, if not on the other side. I was reminded this week that the very first book in the Bible and the very first chapter, Genesis chapter 1, reminds us that the end of day 1 and day 2 and day 3 and day 4 and day 5 and day 6, God ends the magnitude of that created day with these words, and there was evening, and then there was morning. If either Ginger or I had panicked that night instead of stopping, if we had taken off running, if we had screamed, if we had even talked loudly, I believe, to each other, we know that we would have been killed. I'm thankful I stopped in the tracks that night and listened to what she said, and God as well. We had to wait in the darkness for 7 hours that night. I'm convinced that one of the hardest things to do is to wait, wait in the dark. I'm not good at waiting. I've had to rely on a lot of tools to get me through times of waiting for my life to either get back on the right track or for something to happen that I had been praying for and thought would. I've had to let this past year teach me many more things about darkness, about waiting. I'm not an expert, just ask my friends and family who have to help me sometimes. But as Reverend C.C. Jones Davis wrote recently, life is not on pause as we wait. Waiting in the presence of the Lord is our soul's active, patient state that is the birth canal for deliverance. You are not weak when you are waiting. Waiting is a firm assurance that God is in control when something is happening and hanging in the balance. It takes courage and faith to wait, just as it takes courage and faith to act then on God's promises and commands when he feels the waiting is over. My friend Jennifer says that the year 2021 is waiting to unfold. And if you're waiting to do something, there are songs waiting for dancing and journals waiting for words and books waiting for reading and love waiting for receiving and giving and moments waiting for capturing and mountains waiting for climbing and dreams waiting for discovery and prayers waiting for answering and hands waiting for holding, and hearts waiting for fluttering, and spirits waiting for soaring, us waiting for God, and God waiting for us to open our hands and hearts to receive the immeasurably more that he has in store for us. In other words, create a world within a world that you need to sustain and survive in the darkness. Know what life-sustaining practices feed you, like the Word of God, and who feeds you, like those who are close to God and God Himself, who can give you strength as well. I believe this year that we get to take with us a regrounding of what is most important in life. What are our non-negotiables as a Christian, as a follower, as someone seeking? And how can we create and make space for more love and more hope in a world that we want to live in? That night on the trail at 2:30 a.m., a physical light appeared way down below on the trail. Thy word is a lamp unto thy feet and a light unto thy path. All these years later, it's still a scripture I say over and over. It's a scripture that you can say over and over. Those of us who have wounds that are deep and scars that linger on. But I can see the light. It's faint, Lord. Yes, Beth. Just behold me in the dark. I am bringing you good. It might be different than what we expect, but it's called grace. I whisper again that I see the light coming, that my faith might be small as a grain of mustard seed, but I can see it coming, this little light of mine. I'm gonna let it shine for you, Beth, and for all of us here and listening today. I felt silent tears flow down my cheeks as the light came towards us that night. I realized that night if I ever had trust issues with God, who calls me his beloved and you his beloved, they faded in the light of the night. The light was real. You see, two boys were coming down the trail to fish. And they do this one night a year. And they decided that this would be the night to fish. They got a late start on the trail, and thus it was 2:30 in the morning. Coal miners' lamps on their heads, protective gear in their back pockets to ward off the boars, and the hope of Jesus in my heart. I wonder today, do you need to see the light? God, may you bring light to that one listening today who needs to see it down the trail. I don't know what 2021 will bring us this year, and I cannot promise you a year without some darkness. But I do know that his light pierces the darkness. And I promise you, all of us can behold the miracle of the King born in Bethlehem to end our year 2020, who is still on the throne in 2021. And when darkness comes and we think that we can't, we can in his light and in him. Go be light to someone. You know, the mission of God has never changed and it never will. Be a light in a broken world. I decided that one of my verses this year that I'm claiming is Psalm 65:11, which says, "You crown the year with a bountiful harvest, even the hard pathways overflow with abundance." Amen. May 2021 bring us goodness and hope and love and resilience and this gift of newness that will override our weariness and a grace that will cleanse the darkness. I think we all need a fresh breath of the Holy Spirit in and through us and a hand to hold even on the nights with no stars. Amen. Part of our liturgical calendar each year is to celebrate the baptism of Jesus on the second Sunday of January. And last year, we renewed our baptismal vows. It's not a baptism or a rebaptism. It's a day that we can remember and recommit the vows that we made at our baptisms. Baptism is the root and foundation of the Christian life. And in our baptism, we are united to Christ in his death and resurrection, it says in Romans 6. The Christian life is an ongoing experience of the dying of our old selves and the rising of the new. And baptism is a sign under which the whole of life is to be lived. Our baptism is always with us, constantly unfolding through the whole of our life. So today we celebrate and we renew the vows that we took at our baptisms. So join with me in reading the litany responsively. Who is your Lord and Savior? Jesus Christ is my Lord and Savior. Do you renounce the ways of sin that separate you from the love of God? Accepting the Father's love, I renounce all that makes me less than a child of God. Do you renounce all powers in the world that defy God's way of life for all? In the name of Jesus Christ, I renounce them. Will you resist the forces of sin that hold the world in captivity? With the power of the Holy Spirit, I will resist them. Trusting the gracious mercy of God, do you turn from evil to seek good? By the grace of God, I do. You have publicly professed your faith, and will you be a faithful member of this congregation, share in its worship and ministry through your prayers and gifts, your study and service, and so fulfill your calling to be a disciple of Jesus Christ? With God's help, I will follow Christ with my whole heart, mind, body, and soul. Let us pray together a prayer by John Wesley. Holy God, I am no longer my own but yours. Put me to what you will. Rank me with whom you will. Put me to doing. Put me to suffering. Let me be employed for you or laid aside for you, excited for you or brought low for you. Let me be full. Let me be empty. Let me have all things. Let me have nothing. I freely and wholeheartedly yield all things to your pleasure and disposal. And now, glorious and blessed God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, you are mine and I am yours. So be it. And the covenant now made on earth, let it be ratified in heaven. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. As you read in your bulletin, the symbol of the seashell has been associated with baptism since the first centuries of the Christian church. We know this from paintings on the walls of the catacombs where early Christians worshiped, which depict people being baptized with water poured from a seashell. That artistic theme has been carried down through the centuries so that we now find seashells on church banners related to baptisms, in stained glass windows, incorporated into the design of baptismal fonts and printed on baptism announcements. Sometimes the shell is pictured with three drops of water, an allusion to the Trinity of God in whose name we are baptized, the Triune God. And as the music begins to play by Stan, I want to invite you, only if you so desire, to come forward to our baptismal font and dip your hand in the water and take out a seashell as a tangible reminder of the way that you were cleansed, purified, refreshed, and sustained by Jesus Christ, who is himself the living water. Seashells are only in the font. So let us pray. I think think I would ask you first to just come forward as you would and take a shell. Amen. Let us pray. Lord, your word in Mark 6:31 says, "Come away with me by yourselves to a quiet place and rest a while." This is what we have done this morning, Lord. We are an imperfect but sacred people in this sacred sanctuary, sitting at your feet to trade our darkness for your light, reaching out for your hope and peace. And so we bring our empty cups to you, and we ask for you to fill them. We bring our cares to you, and you intimately take them into your scarred hands, and you touch them, and you touch us. We are saved, Lord, by your grace. Our paths are illuminated only by the light of your glory. Our love, your love, is lavished on our hearts that are so desperate for it. And we get to spend every day of our lives sharing your love and light to a lost world. Lord, I am so grateful this morning that as we are here, we don't need to earn your love or question your love or beg for your love. It is always there, free, and it's always enough. So help us to share our stories as an act of faith so they can be a gift to others. Please lead us now and always. And Father, when we think that we can't, help us to know that we can because of your light and your love. And now hear us, Lord, as we pray together the way the church has prayed for generation after generation. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
baptized in water, sealed by the Spirit, cleansed by the blood of Christ our King, heirs of salvation, trusting his promise, faithfully now God's praise we sing. Baptized in water, sealed by the Spirit, dead in the tomb with Christ our King, one with his rising, freed from forgiven, thankfully now God's praise we sing. Baptized in water, sealed by the Spirit, marked with the sign of Christ our King, born of one Father, we are his children, joyfully now God's praise we sing.
As Pastor Allison and I spoke this morning, we reminded each other that it's God and God alone. Amen. May he be glorified. And now receive this benediction. Open unto me light in the darkness. Open unto me courage for my fear. Open unto me hope for my despair. Open unto me peace for my turmoil. Open unto me joy for my sorrow. Open unto me strength for my weakness. Open unto me wisdom for my confusion. Open unto me forgiveness for my sins. Open unto me tenderness for my toughness. Open unto me love for my hates. Open unto me thyself, Lord, for myself. Lord, Lord, open unto me. And together we all said, Amen.